2 weeks ago, I went to Formnext in Frankfurt, which is one of the biggest trade shows about additive manufacturing worldwide, to bring you some of the cool new things I got to see there. Trips like this are supported by our own products you can find at cnckitchen.store and also linked below. We currently run a full week of Black Friday discount with 10% off everything and free shipping in Germany or worldwide free shipping starting at 100 euros. Level up your 3D prints with a vast selection of heatset inserts. Check out our custom heatset insert tools, for example for TS100 and pencil soldering irons and most other common soldering irons, and limited edition signed cases for T18 and Weller tips. We also got some really cool new stuff with high quality stainless steel Torx screws, so you can finally replace all of your annoying socket head cap screws. Also, check out our deburring tool with special thin tips for deburring plastic and our third edition of Volcano adapters made from nickel plated copper. All of this is currently 10% discounted at cnckitchen.store. But let's now get to Formnext. Formnext Frankfurt takes place every year in November, where exhibitors from all over the world gather to show their new and innovative products and processes. I've been to the show for the last 7 years now, and it's great to see how it transitioned from almost exclusively professional multi-$100,000 machines to a mix of business and consumer products. I talked way too much to other visitors, so I wasn't able to see everything, but I still had the chance to see some very interesting and impressive stuff. Sit back and let's take a look at multicolor innovations, new printers, hardware, zebra filament, glass filament, and material recycling. So let's start with Elegoo's Orange Storm Giga, their new huge scale 800x800x1000mm 3D printer that they recently launched on Kickstarter and already collected over $3.5 million, with over 2000 machines being backed for. Unfortunately, their booth staff wasn't super motivated to give me a detailed tour of the machine, but the scale of that thing was still impressive, and I'm wondering if everyone who will be getting one of these machines really has space for it. The design itself is reasonably simple, with a stationary bed and the whole XY gantry that's lifting up using 4 separate lead screws. I can't really wrap my head around if the bed design is super smart or just super lazy, because it uses 4 individual 400mm print beds with separate PEI sheets. This allows the user to print smaller parts on only one segment without needing to heat the whole giant bed. They equip the printhead with a very necessary high flow hot end, and if you take a look at the Kickstarter page, you will also be able to add 4 of them in parallel. Parallel means that they will all be connected to the same belt, so you won't be able to do multi-material prints, but basically print 4 identical models at the same time. With a targeted MSRP of $2,500, this might definitely become a very competitive machine on the large print volume market. But since simply scaling up a small printer is not enough to make a good big machine, we won't be able to tell how good it will perform until we see units really ship out. Another machine from an established brand that might soon launch a Kickstarter is the Frozen Arco. We know Frozen primarily from their range of resin printers, yet they are currently dipping their toes into the waters of FDM and showed their Arco in a corner, which from very far away resembles a bit a Bambulab P1P. Unfortunately, I didn't get a ton of specs yet, but they might release more in the Arco soon. It didn't print, and I was told that they're still heavily working on it. It has a 300mm cube build volume, uses a Core XY motion system on a flying gantry, and in general tries to cater to the currently very popular Core XY market. Yet what many others didn't dare is getting into the multicolor or multi-material printing market. They showed a filament box on the printer which looks very similar to an AMS, and since the machine is supposed to run Clipper, this box might become a very cool general purpose accessory for other machines, because it will need to work with open source firmware. Bambulab's booth was honestly one of the nicest ones from the whole show, and one of the only ones where a chain stopped you from entering, which was a bit, well, unconventional. Maybe the reason for that was that Alex Chappell was building a huge replica of a P1P behind the scenes using a wall of X1Es. I'm honestly a bit upset that I didn't see it in its full finished state. Bamboo Lab didn't show anything new, yet it was the first chance for me to take a look at their Enterprise X1E, which mainly distinguishes itself from the X1 Carbon by the 350 degrees hot end and the heated chamber, which also has a proper air filtration system. The X1E is $1,000 more expensive than a regular X1, and as far as I'm aware, not directly available over Bamboo Lab's web store and is only distributed by resellers. The additional 1000 bucks is probably not what the new hardware costs, but rather gives the resellers a bit of margin to work with. For a business, it's easier to buy these machines from an established local reseller compared to a Chinese company, especially if you're also looking for direct support and maintenance contracts. I'm trying to get my hands on one because I'd really like to see what technical difference the upgrades on the X1E make, so maybe there might be a review of one in the future. Another hugely popular booth at Formnext is also always the one from Prusa. On the consumer side, they of course showed the 5-tool XL running, which is now finally shipping, as well as the enclosed version for higher demanding materials. Unfortunately, no other new consumer machines were shown, even though so many would have probably liked to have one of the small CoreXY printers that are in the AFS, which is their automatic manufacturing system. It's always nice to look at, they showed some new soft and hardware features, and also it now uses the Nextruder as print heads. Yet the big thing at Prusa's booth was the new Prusa Pro series. The most interesting machine for me was the HT90, which might look familiar to some. With Prusa Pro, Prusa tries to get all of their other brands under one banner. The HT90 is based on the Trilab machines that Prusa acquired a while back. The HT90 is mainly focused on high temperature materials, so PEI, PEC or polycarbonate. The Delta printer has a 500 degree hot end and a 90 degree heated chamber and does really look nice. Even though they try to get the same look and feel on the machine as on the other Prusa machines, the HT90 actually uses Duet hardware, runs Clipper and is developed by a separate team. The other new Prusa Pro machine was the SLX, which looked like a giant version of the SL1S, also with a tilting vat mechanism and a massive resin container. This machine still seems to be under development, and I wasn't able to get many specs besides the 12K monochrome LCD display. Next on the list was Duet 3D, which we've also seen being used on the Prusa Pro HT90. Duet boards usually run RepRap firmware, but it was very interesting to see that some even use it with Clipper firmware. But that just as a side note. It might be debatable if there are significant benefits from that decision or if the market is just demanding Clipper. Yet it still shows what Duet is known for, and that's reliable and advanced electronics for all sorts of printers, and they prominently demonstrated that with a multi-axis E3D tool changer and the tiny 5-axis Voron Zero by Brandon Builds. Tony told me that they are noticing that their market in the maker community shrinks, so they are more and more focusing on the OEM market. So they showed their new servo motors for reliable movements and their data collection possibilities to monitor the systems and perform quality control. Yet they aren't abandoning the consumer market, and they also showed that with their inductive bed leveling probe, which uses the same chip as the popular Beacon sensor and allows very fast and high resolution bed probing. Something else that they've shown are their toolboards to get rid of the thick wiring looms of 3D printers. These PCBs directly mount onto your printhead and include all the power electronics for running the heaters, fans, stepper motors, and also include an accelerometer. You then only have a data cable for CAN FD as well as power. They showed this on E3D's new Roto extruder, at which we'll take a closer look at in a second. In contrast to Clipper's implementation of regular CAN, Duet mainboards and toolboards use CAN FD, which is more flexible and has a significantly higher data rate, getting around many of the challenges that arise with Clipper CAN toolboards. So the big thing over at E3D's booth was their new Roto extruder, which is following the market trend of making extruders smaller and lighter. The motor side reminded me of an Orbital V2 with a compact stepper motor and a planetary gearbox, yet what stands out is the new heatsink. Whereas other extruders and hot end combinations require separate heatsinks, E3D started using the extruder cover as a heatsink with their Himera, which makes the whole setup significantly shorter. Whereas Himera still used a die-cast housing, which limits design freedom, Roto now uses an aluminum 3D printed extruder cover, which is also a sophisticated heatsink for the Revo hot end. I'm really happy to see laser power bed fusion being used in such a product, because it opens up design opportunities that weren't possible before. Roto also has a nice latching idler arm, and can be equipped with a filament runout sensor, and we have already seen the compact implementation with the Duet tool board. Other than that, they showed a Diamondback Revo nozzle, which I find a really interesting alternative to E3D's Obsidian nozzle. They also had the nipple, belt nozzle on display, which due to its shape can be used for belt printers or for non-planar printing. It's great to see that E3D remains strong in the hotend and extruder business and is featured in a wide range of machines, including some I wouldn't have expected. From E3D to another very innovative extrusion system that I would have almost missed, this is Anchormake's V6 color engine that was shown at the booth of 3D Prima. I still haven't gotten my hands on Anchormake's first entry of 3D printers, the M5 or M5C, but this is the one many have been waiting for. This is basically a 6-color version of the M5 called V6. Initially, I would have expected that they just went the easy route and implemented a multiplexing system similar to what Bamboo Labs AMS does, with all of the waste and color change time involved. You might have noticed that this machine has a huge print head. This is due to the reason that there are 6 individual hotends under the hood, so you don't need to purge any material when changing colors. The innovative thing here is the included mechanism that rises the unused hotend and covers the nozzle tip with a silicone pad so that no material can ooze out. This should theoretically result in very quick color changes without any waste. The nozzles are calibrated to each other with a small sensor base that's getting fixed to the print bed during the initial setup. All the materials are fed from a cabinet next to the machine, which also houses the extrusion motors and acts as a dry box. Whereas the existing Anchormake machine had a direct extruder on the printhead, the V6 needs to use a Bowden system with quite long tubes, simply because you can't fit 6 extruders onto the already bulky printhead. How that will affect print quality and speed is something we'll see once they hopefully are going to ship it in the first half of next year. While I had mixed feelings about the M5 series, especially because I never had the chance to test one, I'm stoked to see this kind of innovation here, even though we don't know all of the drawbacks yet. Next, I stopped by another multicolor printing option at the booth of Coprint. Their Chroma set aims to bring speed and multicolor to almost any 3D printer. Their Chroma head is a replacement direct extruder printing head that can be fitted on a wide variety of machines out in the wild. The novelty of the Chroma head is that it features a filament cutter, similar to what Bamboo Lab made popular. That eliminates the risk of dragging molten material back up into the multiplexing system. The Chroma head is paired with a bunch of feeders on the top of the machine that push the selected filament to the head during material changes. They say they can support up to 20 materials, yet we can currently only imagine how a setup like this could look like. The Coprint is also aimed to make printing faster and wants to bring Clipper to any machine. So if you have a printer that already runs Clipper, you can plug your multicolor system into your machine with just a small box. If you have an older machine, you need the Chroma pad, which not only acts as an easy control for your machine, but will also flash the necessary firmware on your printer to run Clipper. The machines at the booth were still prototypes, and they are currently running a Kickstarter for it, but they showed some really nice multicolor and even multi-material prints, and if they get the hardware a bit more cleaned up, this might become a nice aftermarket solution to get more out of your old printer. Yet at a target retail price of $500 to $650, it might not be the easiest sell compared to already existing multi-material machines. Yet if you don't own or if you don't want a multi-material printer, then there were some really nice gradient materials shown at the booth of probably one of the biggest filament manufacturers worldwide, ESUN. Regular gradient or rainbow filament usually has very slow color transitions, which sometimes don't even show properly up on small prints. Yet they managed to make a material that transitions very quickly from one to another color, leading to almost a zebra pattern on a part. If you are interested in these rather aesthetic materials, it might be worth taking a look at them. I personally would rather be interested in how they're making this kind of filament. I wasn't able to get an answer, but I suspect they're using a co-extrusion process with 2 or more extruders, and rather than extruding colors simultaneously into one filament, they might regularly switch between them to get this kind of effect. Next, I stopped by at ColorFab, who had been bringing innovations like their foaming PLA or the VarioShore TPU to the market in the past. They're very focused on sustainability and, for example, showed their Viber PLA, which is a PLA filled with elephant grass fibers that act as a very sustainable filler, reducing the carbon footprint of the filament and giving the material a lovely matte appearance. Yet, something that needs to be properly highlighted is their PHA filament. PHA is also a biopolymer made using fermentation using a wide range of different sugars or fats, even from waste, and unlike PLA, doesn't necessarily depend on primary food sources like corn. Yet, this isn't the highlight of this material. PHA, unlike PLA, will degrade in your regular home compost and even in a relatively short amount of time in almost any other environment without leaving microplastics behind. I tried it myself already a year ago and was very impressed with it. It prints almost as nice as PLA, though currently still has a higher warping tendency with bigger parts and is still more expensive. Yet if you're looking for a real green alternative for PLA, I'd highly suggest taking a look at PHA. Only if we adopt it, buy it and use it, they'll have the funds to improve it further and make it more affordable. I honestly really hope that this might become a sensible alternative for all of our disposable plastics. Yet, if you still print with a lot of PLA and want to recycle it, there are companies like the Recycling Fabric on the market that will take your print waste and make new filament from it. They have a reward system where you get a discount on materials in their shop if you send in your waste. I've already been to their booth last year and wanted to check in again how they're doing. They told me that one of the biggest things that they're struggling with is the acceptance of customers that their recycled filament is of similar quality as the one made from virgin material. They seriously do their best to make sure that it prints and behaves just like new material by cleaning and filtering the material during manufacturing. Yet, since the raw material price is only a minor fraction of the final price of your roll of filament, they can't offer their material significantly cheaper than one made from pellets. Yet, at around 20 euros per kilogram, it's still decently priced, and you support making great filament from waste streams. Another waste stream that can be made into filament are old fishing nets. Fishy Filaments by Filamentum showed exactly this and presented their nylon and carbon fiber reinforced nylon made completely out of PA6 fishing nets. I really love seeing initiatives like this because this doesn't only reduce the amount of waste out in the nature, but also significantly reduces the carbon footprint of this tough engineering material. If you are a business or an institution that wants to research or do small-scale production of filament, then 3Devo might have the right solution for you. They showed their overhauled filament extruder at Formnext, which features way more intuitive controls, but one of the most important things is their new 3-axis filament sensor. It uses 3 cameras to determine the diameter of the filament faster and at a significantly higher resolution as before. And they set up a demo I couldn't stop playing with. I have their old extruder and I really hope to get my hands on this new machine once it releases to do more filament experiments for and with you. And finally, another recycled 3D printing material, but this one is a bit out of the ordinary. This is Maple Glass from Melbourne, Australia, who does 3D printing with glass. Their machines are not super different from the ones that we use, yet the heated chamber is basically a kiln going up several hundreds of degrees, and the nozzle and hot end are made from high temperature superalloys heating up way over 1000 degrees Celsius. The exciting thing here is that they are not only building 3D printers, but also the machine that makes the 1 meter long glass rods that are the filament for printing, and which are made from waste glass, giving some prints these transition colors. Of course, not everyone has an application for such a machine, but if you want to get your digital designs quickly made from real glass, Maple Glass might be the ones to check out. These translucent parts with the really thick layers are just always a pleasure to look at. And there we have it. This was the rest of my coverage of Formnext 2023. I hope you liked this format and maybe I was able to show you some new and exciting stuff. If you want to support my work, make sure to check out the Black Friday deals in our online shop at cnckitchen.store.